It's not hyperbole to say that one can hardly imagine a more appropriate person than Barry Posen to deliver the annual Kenneth Waltz Lecture on International Relations. Barry was a protege of Ken Waltz, and while he's his own man in research and commentary, I think his convictions and sense of direction reflect and honor Waltz's. And more than Ken himself, Barry integrates careful empirical analysis with his theoretical insights. And I can't help remembering that before the 1980s, political scientists thought hard about nuclear targeting strategy and deterrence, theoretical abstractions that have never been tested, at least fully. But they didn't do much about conventional military strategy, operations, and tactics, a subject they pretty much left to military historians and war buffs. Barry Posen was one of the pioneers who delved deeper into how what we can know of the actual conduct of war should inform us, and more wisely than most politicians tend to be informed, about the causes and consequences of war, and hence the risks, costs, and benefits that should be weighed in decisions about when and where the United States of America should and should not fight or threaten to fight. Barely out of graduate school, Barry's first book, The Sources of Military Doctrine, won two prizes, including the Woodrow Wilson Award for Best Book in Political Science, beating out impressive contenders outside of strategic studies, such as Bob Cohen's magnum opus, After Hegemony. And Posen's second book, Inadvertent Escalation, was a blockbuster, analyzing in careful, persuasive, and alarming detail the probability that a war in Europe could escape control of deliberate strategic decisions by political leaders. But it gained less attention because it was published just after the Cold War ended, misleading many to assume that its concerns were passé, and I commend it to you as a source of wisdom more timeless than its empirical detail might suggest, and relevant, for example, to how we should think about the growing potential for wartime interaction between the United States and China. And Barry's third book is the subject of his lecture today. And he wrote this rationale for restraint before Islamic State unraveled Iraq and Syria, and Russia annexed Crimea and intervened in Ukraine, and China flexed its muscles over a breathtaking set of claims to Western Pacific waters. So now he'll tell us why he's still right.
Well, thanks for the nice introduction, Dick. I appreciate that. It's an honor to be here. Ken was my mentor, and he meant a lot, and you know, to me and to my intellectual development in many ways. Some of which were let's say less gentle than others. But I always learned from those interactions, and I think it made me a better scholar. As many of you know, Dick mentioned, I finished this book, Restraint, A New Foundation for U.S. Grand Strategy. We just finished it last year, and it was published in May. And I can't deny that it's about the only thing I can talk about these days. So I've come to talk a little bit about the book, but also to try and take up Dick's challenge to try and think a little bit about events that have occurred since I put the book to bed, and to try and ask what does restraint say about those events, and not only why they happened, but what we might do. Was that a fire alarm? Oh, well, hopefully mine isn't on. Although sometimes I'd like to leave it on to wake myself up in the middle of my own talks. Many academics in the room know that this is the case. So what I'm going to do is just briefly sketch out the architecture of the book, then sketch out a little bit of the meat of the argument. Then I'll review a bit about, particularly I'll talk about Russia and a little bit about ISIL, and how the emergence of these problems actually illustrates many of the problems that restraint talks about. And then I'll give a few suggestions about how we might proceed. And I haven't given the talk this way before, so I beg your indulgence in terms of timing and brevity and things like that. I'll be maneuvering here to go back to my conventional war days. So the book has it's mercifully short, and it basically just does a handful of things. I describe the evolution of post-Cold War U.S. grand strategy. I offer a critique of how that strategy has worked or not worked since the Cold War ended, which is really kind of the meat of the story. I lay out the political outlines of an alternative. I talk about alternative strategies, you know, sub-strategies in four regions of the world on two problems. And then, because it is an interest or hobby of mine, military forces and force structure, I try and lay out a military strategy that supports the political strategy, and I try and develop an illustrative force structure and a defense budget, right? So I try and do all those things, and then I close up with some prognostications about the chances for any of this advice to be taken. So here's the problem as I see it. There's a considerable degree of consensus in the American national security elite on U.S. grand strategy. And this is a pretty well-informed audience, so I won't spend a lot of time on basics and primitives. We can return to these if you want. But for me, a grand strategy, simple one-liner, states theory about how to cause security for itself. So what is the grand strategy? I've started calling it liberal hegemony. That's what I call it in the book. I think John Eikenberry, who's sort of an exponent of the strategy, at least in one of his books or one of the things he wrote, called it liberal hegemony, and I think that's a good term. The title sort of tells all. The proponents of this strategy, and I think they span the Democratic-Republican parties, were pretty happy with that unipolar moment that emerged when the Cold War ended. And what was a happy accident became a sine qua non of U.S. security, a sine qua non to be protected, but also to be leveraged in pursuit of liberal principles. The good guys won the Cold War. Liberals won the Cold War. There's a whole body of thinking in the United States that says that, you know, if we can build a world according to these principles, it'll be safe for us and safe for others for very long time. So pretty much everything matters in this strategy. So democracy promotion happens, market economy promotion happens, it matters, international free trade matters, at least for some people, liberal institutions, international institutions matter. Protecting our old alliances to build upon, to protect our power position and build upon in terms of maintaining, sustaining influence in the world, all matters. Rising states matter. Declining states matter. Everything matters, right? Power, principle, married together for a big project, right? And, you know, one of the aspects of the strategy that I think are important that it's second nature to me, this I often don't mention it, is that to me the strategy seems rather under-prioritized. In other words, most students of strategy would say that, strategy in part is about setting priorities, right? It's about managing scarcity. You know, Bernard Brody has a chapter somewhere, War in Politics, that says, strategy wears a dollar sign, right? So given how powerful the Americans were, they didn't really think too much about this. And given that the economy was going great guns when this strategy started, you didn't have to think that much about scarcity. True, the defense budget shrunk when the Cold War ended, as it should have, but you were still spending close to 3% of GDP on defense, and it was still a pretty big and capable force, and we trotted it out from time to time, and it usually performed pretty well. And that's one of the great oddities. You know, the United States leaves the Cold War with this tremendous power position, tremendous preeminent power position, and yet the United States is at war pretty often. In fact, just measured in terms of months per epoch, so to speak, relative to the Cold War, Bob Work, who's now the Deputy Secretary of Defense, used to have a briefing that he used to do on this. The United States had been in war about twice as often as it was during the Cold War. Now, of course, most of the wars not as brutal as the Cold War, hot wars, Cold War, hot wars. But still, this is odd, right? Powerful, safe country at war a lot of the time. What's that all about, and is it reasonable? So a strategy that's ambitious, under-prioritized, and pretty warlike, right? Kind of a odd thing for this country, at least seems to me. Now, I'd like to, when I do in the book and when I do this talk, I like to kind of come back to first principles, right? Actually facts or factoids, whatever you want to call them, right? About the American security position. So I was talking a second ago about, you know, sort of unipolarity at the end of the Cold War, just what a great power advantage the United States had, but it's easy to forget, right? The U.S. is a very rich country. It's a very productive economy. Now, we can play with, extrapolations of China's growth rate or India's growth rate, and I do some of that in the book, and there's no doubt that the degree of sort of economic preeminence the United States enjoyed when the Cold War ended is going to disappear. There's going to be convergence, right? But nevertheless, the United States is going to be one of the top two or three economies in the world, and even if it isn't, the top one on points, it's probably still going to be the one you'd rather have if you're playing a game of strategy, right? Because it's such a diverse and capable economy, and we should remember that we also live in a pretty good continent. The continent's been good to the United States. I mean, when I drove from Washington to Boston take up a pre-doctoral fellowship, it was the year they had odd and even gas fill-ups because we were in an energy crisis, right? America was not energy independent, and somehow it appears that the United States might be energy independent again, at least for a time. It's a good continent, right? And we drew good cards here. And this is another powerful contributor to American power and security. The oceans are still there. Distance matters. When we talk about threats to the United States, you hear people sort of saying, gee, technology has really made distance not matter. When you talk to the military about going to some other place to do something, suddenly distance matters again, right? And we've invested huge amounts of money in our country in overcoming the effects of distance, and nevertheless, distance still matters. Time still matters. Well, if it matters going out, it matters going in. It's still an enormous utility to American security, as is the good fortune or consequences of strategic action that we have relatively weak and pliant neighbors to the north and south. So again, pretty safe country. Some people worry about trade. I'm not an expert on trade. I like to sort of fake being a political economist, but about a third of American trade's in this hemisphere, right? The rest of it is scattered among a lot of different countries. A whole lot of bad things would have to happen in the world to take the benefits of trade, whatever they are, and I'm not going to try and make that case, but to take the benefits of trade from the United States, a whole lot of dominoes would have to fall, really a whole lot of dominoes. The United States has a great military and great military technology, and it's not just because we feed the meter every year, it's because we've been feeding the meter every year since at least 1940, right? So we've built a terrific military R&D base, great defense industry. Yes, the weapons are quite expensive, and yes, they often come in late, right? And they often have teething troubles. But in the end, when the smoke clears, the weapons turn out to be pretty darn good, and they're the ones that set the world standard. And we have really good professional military people who are quite good at using those things. Again, enormous advantage. And finally, we live in the nuclear age, and my mentor would sometimes, Ken would sort of, do the more the merrier kind of thing, and I'm not quite there. I think nuclear weapons are here to stay. I don't think global zero is going to happen. I personally don't think it's in America's interest. And it's very hard to conquer a country that has nuclear weapons, right? The United States, it's just not something you can do, especially a country that has a lot of nuclear weapons. The United States is the greatest nuclear power in the world, right? So if some ambitious country wanted to come after the United States, the obstacles to be overcome, the risks to be run, are huge, right? Now, these facts are so evident that they're never discussed. I mean, you hear discussions about American grand strategy that start with threats that are elucidated and listed, from all over the world, and people don't come back to first principles. we're in good shape in this country. Now, I argue in the book that not just that we're in good shape, but the strategy we've pursued, right, is not working particularly well. So we don't really have to be as energetic as we are. And being as energetic as we are has various peculiar costs and risks attached to it, right? And I only talk about three classes of costs and risks. One is given by, you know, the religion into which I was socialized by Kent. I'm a kind of a realist. Realism's a big tent. I think most realists agree on the influence of anarchy on the behavior of states. Most realists agree that states are out for themselves, right? So there's three phenomena that we see in the world that I think realism predicts that tell us why this strategy is not working so well, but also predict more difficulty in the future for reasons I'll discuss in a second, right? One is other states are as interested in protecting their sovereignty and their discretion and their space as we are interested in defending ours. And if they have the capacity to push back against the United States, they will. Now, this balancing, which, you know, folk like me and Ken were predicting ever since the Cold War ended, was sort of slow to emerge, right? And I think the reason why it was slow to emerge was because we started out with this terrific advantage. It was very hard to tilt with the United States. But there's been internal balancing, and there is external balancing. The Russians have rebuilt at least a small piece of their military power from a situation of having really next to nothing. They have a potent, moderate-sized capability, and we've saw it making mischief, right? So the country that was easy to push around when we started on this project has, through its own efforts, made itself harder to push around. China's economy is growing, not because they decided to make it grow to balance the United States per se. They decided to make it grow because they wanted to be a modern state. But this gives them more resources from which to extract military power, and they are. And the Chinese and the Russians both have their problems with us, and each is dimly aware of the other's existence. So this is what international politics looks like. This is, you know, this is what balance of power politics looks like. So Russia and China have not signed some NATO-like alliance, but they work together on little projects. Russia was happy to sell China all kinds of weaponry, energy deals, lines of communication running east and west, landlines, which have the effect of weakening a little bit the power of U.S. sea power to harass China in some future date. All of these things, plus each lives in the knowledge, each of the states lives in the knowledge that they're both tilting with the United States. So if Russia's tilting this week, China has an opening at the same time. If China's tilting this week, Russia has an opening, right? So it's starting to look more like a multipolar system. Ken would not agree with that description. He would probably say it looks bipolar to him, or still looks kind of unipolar, but to me it looks multipolar. These are heuristics. We could have a religious discussion about this. But there's balancing behavior happening, I would say that. And it seems like suddenly there's a lot more happening. And of course, this is what gives rise to the sky is falling, you know, narrative, which we've had in, you know, recent months, right? That, you know, everything that's happened in recent months is somehow the consequence of things that the United States did not do because of a, you know, particularly naive or disengaged president. This doesn't make sense to me. Things are going the way they are because of trends that have been in train since the Cold War ended, trends which we could have predicted, right? Now, there's two other problems that happen with your allies, which I think are essentially problems that realism predicts. One is cheap and free riding, right? In other words, the more, United States is kind of funny. We make extravagant security promises to our allies. And for some reason, we're very sensitive to their concerns. When they tell us they're worried about our commitments, we run around like chickens with our heads cut off trying to make them feel better, right? And the observation that if you're really scared, why don't you, the Japanese, spend a bit more than 1% of GDP on defense? If you, the Europeans, are really scared, why don't you spend a bit more than 1.6% of GDP on defense? Right? These are rich countries. They can afford to do a lot more, right? And I'm not talking saying that somehow the world is so dangerous that they should be spending 3 or 4 or 5% of GDP on defense. The Americans are spending about 4 right now, I believe. Right? It's not that what I'm looking for, but these countries cut it to the bone, right? They cut it to the bone, and this produces a kind of a tail chase problem for us. The more we do, the less they seem to feel compelled to do. And then they holler about how insecure they feel, and we feel like we have to do more, right? This is another thing that contributes to the costliness of the U.S. grand strategy, at least in terms of dollars. Now, finally, there's a problem. I think I might get credit for this term. I'm not sure if I do, but I call it reckless driving, right? This is the other side of free and cheap riding. Right, where states feel so secure in the American relationship with the American commitment that they make mischief on their own accounts. They do things that we've advised them against, or they fail to do things that we've advised them to do, things that seem commonsensical to us and I think commonsensical to me. Right, but for their own reasons, they either do or do not do these things. And the United States ends up, in some sense, holding some piece of the bag. Right, so who are these reckless drivers? Our clients in Afghanistan and Iraq. I mean, the Karzai regime, the Maliki regime. You know, Maliki was driving recklessly. You know, he drove so recklessly that he even managed to convince his own people he was taking the car into a ditch. So the Americans said, maybe it's time to change drivers. He said, well, maybe you're right. Right? They felt comfortable. You know, we're not going to abandon him. Same with Karzai. Countries that drive recklessly. Is it really necessary for the Japanese Prime Minister to visit the Yasukuni Shrine and rub salt in old wounds? Is this necessary? Right? It doesn't seem so to me. This business with the island, the Daoyus and Kakos, this looks a little reckless to me. I get into trouble with some audiences on this one. Israelis drive recklessly in their settlement policy in the territories. It's reckless driving. We have asked, cajoled, demanded, right? And why do we do this? Well, it's not because we think this is the magic key to peace in the region. I'm not sure there is a magic key, right? But it makes it harder, and it also just makes it harder for the Americans to do other things that they want to do in the Arab world, right? We pay a cost for this, right? We're not very good at disciplining the reckless drivers. We're not very good at encouraging the cheap riders. It's become a hearty staple for outgoing SecDefs to suddenly get religion on burden sharing in the alliance. Usually it's the last 6 to 12 months of their tenure. They've been going to really nice parties in Europe for 4 or 6 or however many years they've been SecDef, and everything's been fine. And then the last year they suddenly get religion on burden sharing. They give a few ringing speeches and then they're gone and the next guy come in and he's happy to go to the same parties. And so for several more years, nothing much gets said, right? Now, I mentioned that I thought that, particularly on the balancing side, but also on these other matters, things are probably going to get harder. And I mentioned this earlier about potential convergence of economic potential. And we should all, I guess, economists would tell us to be agnostic about these linear extrapolations of Chinese growth or Indian growth or whatever it is. But people who've been looking at this for a long time, like the National Intelligence Council, Director of National Intelligence, in these out-year projection documents, the world in 2025, world in 2030, they've been talking about what they call the diffusion of power. And what they really mean by this is other states are becoming modern, right? And aside from other states becoming modern and getting some economic growth, which is the sinews of military power, even non-state actors, groups, whatever, they're getting more capable, right? So those inclined to balance against us have more capacity with which to balance. Those inclined to fight us seem to have more capacity with which to fight us. Now, this is a little mysterious, needs a paper. I'm not sure the paper has been written yet. The United States somehow spent as many real dollars in direct costs of the Iraq War before we started it back up again. Direct costs of the Iraq War as we spent in Vietnam. This is real dollars, adjusted for inflation. Right? And this doesn't count costs of veterans after the fact or medicine or anything after the fact, just direct costs of the war, $700 or $800 billion, something like that. Now, how is this possible? Right? The opposition in Vietnam had open charge accounts in the arsenals of China and Russia. Right? There was plenty of foreign aid, plenty of assistance, plenty of weapons, plenty of advice. Right? In Iraq, the opposition was basically running off what it could find in Iraq. Now, yes, Saddam Hussein had stockpiled quite a lot of military stuff. And yes, there were wads of cash lying around, right? But if you try and count any of this money and compare it to money spent in Vietnam and what the CIA thought the other side was spending in the Vietnam War, and all these are very, very squishy figures. I'm not going to, don't take any of this to the bank, right? But maybe we outspent the other side in Vietnam by a factor of 10 to 1, maybe a bit more, right? In dollar terms, we probably outspent the other side in Iraq by maybe a factor of 200 to 1. In both cases, to bring the war to a kind of a bloody, unhappy stalemate that in the end cascaded in the wrong direction, but did take them both to a kind of a bloody stalemate. But this, you know, we can't afford too many more Iraqs if we're going to have this kind of cost exchange rate. Now, it is true that many fewer Americans died in the Iraq War than in Vietnam, and we should all be glad about that. But we should also have a caveat here, which we don't know, we don't have a complete understanding of the human physical costs of that war to the soldiers who fought it. You know, there's two aspects of this. One is post-traumatic stress disorder, and the other is traumatic brain injury. And there's a lot of traumatic brain injury. So there's a lot of actual physical wounds, not apparent to the naked eye, that have negative consequences for many years thereafter. And if you just look at any of the old briefing slides the Pentagon used to put up on numbers of IEDs, improvised explosive devices, numbers found and not detonated versus numbers detonated, the number detonated is really large. Right? I can't give you a precise number offhand, but it was really large. And if you assume that it detonated because someone was near it to make it worth detonating, you have to assume that there's a lot of people who, in the American military and allied militaries, who got rattled, right? And we're seeing some of the consequences of that. So while we should be satisfied, happy that casualty rates, as we understand them, seem lower in Iraq, we also shouldn't be too cocky about it, because the bad guys got very good in Iraq at these improvised explosive devices. And this is the poor man's precision guided munition. For us to fire a precision guided munition, we have to find a target, have this fancy munition, put the munition on the target. The poor man's BGM works the other day. He puts the munition on there and he waits for the target to come to it and then he detonates it. Right? And his are much cheaper than ours. IEDs are very cheap. Right? And they got very good technology. You can go to I've been to the National Training Center and to the there's a little section there that does IED training for the troops. And they have the entire library of detonators, munitions, every other thing. And the bad guys were infinitely creative and stayed in the game, seesaw, back and forth, to the end. Right? So again, right, there's things happening in the world that make the military part of the project, I think, much more expensive over time. And the final thing I want to say something about here is nationalism and identity politics. Right? So this is a room full of people who study international politics and political science. We all know that our field, comparative politics, we've been writing a lot about identity politics for the last 15, 20 years, a lot about nationalism. Right? I'm not sure we have any particular consensus on this. But I observe that there's a lot of identity politics in the world. And I observe now, as well as historically, that it's not so difficult to mobilize a self-aware group of people against what appears to be an external occupation and guidance about how to govern their politics, right? So we see people mobilizing around nationalism, around ethnicity, around religion. They don't like each other when they think that another group is going to try and lord it over them, and they don't like us when we come to do it, right? And since the days of the French Revolution, we have understood that identity politics is a powerful tool for mobilizing large numbers of 18-year-old males to go out and do things that really seem insane, right? You can get them to kill and we can get them to die. We can get them to take enormous risks, right? And part of this problem we ran into in Iraq has to do with not just the collision with, you know, more capable populations, more capable groups, but a collision with an ability to mobilize, right? Which we're seeing to this day, right? Now I'm going to kind of shift gears here, and I'm going to just say a few words about Iraq and Ukraine, right? And I don't know how long you want me to go. I mean, just have at it here. Okay, so what's that?
Keep going.
It's what you came for. So Dick was funny. He came up with the title for this talk, but I literally had the exact question asked by a defense. I gave the talk in the Brookings in Washington last week, and defense journalist, a guy who's been in the trade a long time, who I greatly respect, he'll go unnamed here because it's just the rules of the game, but really smart, wise, longtime defense journalist in one of the magazines, not newspapers. He says to me, everything you say makes a lot of sense, but I just feel uneasy about it because the world's going to hell in a handbasket, right? And I said, okay. One thing I would say, at least in terms of thinking about what to do with some of these problems that now seem so pressing, is to ask a few questions about how the strategy that we have been pursuing may have helped make those problems worse or created those problems altogether. Right? We should be asking that question, because the implied remedy for many in the policy discourse is we just need to do more of what we were doing. Right? We stopped doing a lot of what we were doing for however many years President Obama was not doing it, and if we only had been doing it, everything would be fine. So the answer is, let's go back to doing those things and doing them with vigor, right? So let's just review the bidding here, things that people don't want to think about. The decision to attack Iraq in 2003 was most assuredly not restrained, right? This was not an action that a restrainer would take. Most of the people I know who advocate restraint spent their own money to take out an ad in the New York Times to oppose that war, including me. But if you excavate it, you can sort of see some of the characteristic errors of the liberal hegemony strategy. One is a question of priorities. We weren't really done in Afghanistan. Whatever you think about the wisdom of the Afghan war, and by the way, at the time I supported it, we weren't done, and we knew we weren't done. We had lots of evidence that we weren't done, right? If you've ever studied this one, aside from the fact that we didn't have Osama bin Laden, this fight, the Anaconda fight, it sort of should have told people that the bad guys really were still pretty frisky out there, right? It wasn't smart to turn to this second war. Second, whatever you think about the sincerity of the U.S. government's concerns about Iraqi weapons of mass destruction, and I personally do not think this was the main reason for the war, there was little reason to believe that whatever may have been in train in Saddam's programs, whatever the intelligence community thought it saw, was pretty limited and pretty primitive. And relative to the kinds of capabilities that the United States has, we could have taken a little more time to be sure. It was no great risk being assumed to kind of waiting a bit longer to see, right? So instead there was this kind of, got to get out there, it's really dangerous for us. Well, remember who we are and where we are and what we have, right? How dangerous can Saddam Hussein really be to the United States of America, right? And the way we thought about using force, you all remember the debate about what happens after the initial victories and what kind of troop strength it will take to police this place, how we'll put the politics back together, all done in a very casual and slipshod way, right? Our force will overwhelm all resistance. Once the war was done, the U.S. insisted on banishing anybody who'd been associated with the prior regime. Now, this either shows a deep ignorance of the identity politics of the country, which is what I was saying earlier. The Americans don't seem to have a good feel for identity politics, right? Or a kind of very knee-jerk commitment to this idea that liberal democracy will just naturally triumph overall, the liberalism and liberal hegemony. I don't know, right? But some combination thereof, probably. Right? As it became clear in the country that you really weren't going to get much of an accommodation between the three major groups, solution sets that called for some variety of partition, right? And it didn't have to be a kind of, you know, let's have a divorce and we'll have three flags and three seats at the UN, but some kind of significant partitioning of the real estate and the money, right, was not a strategy the United States got behind. We continue to stick with, as we did in Bosnia, by the way, the idea that there's going to be one country here, right? There can be, right? To this day, voices of the American elite insist that somehow the United States could have maintained its political military tutelage over the Iraqi state on an open-ended basis, and everything that came later could somehow have been prevented. Right? Well, we can go back and look at, you know, what happened when the Bush-SOFA Status of Forces Agreement was developed. The Americans, to get the cooperation of the Iraqis, to get the cooperation of the Baghdad regime, the Americans had to promise to get out of the country. And we had to promise to do some other things which people forget. We promised to pull our forces out of the cities, right, in 09. There's lots of things we needed to promise. And we needed to promise those things because lots of Iraqis didn't want us there anymore, right? Iraqi nationalism was alive and well, right? And if it wasn't Iraqi nationalism, then it was Shiite hegemonism, you know, another kind of identity politics. But whatever it was, right, we weren't going to be allowed to stay around there. Right? And I think this retrospective argument that there was a way that this could have happened is, to me, it's fantastical. And finally, we have to, I don't spend all my days reading, you know, literature about terrorists and terrorist organizations. I'm not the world's expert on ISIL, but just a casual reading of news coverage of the region tells you that much of the ISIL leadership are people who are known to us in a rather intimate way, right? These are people who pass through our jails, in some cases for many months. Or they're ex-Baathist military officers, the ones we, excluded from power and politics in that country, right? Or both, ex-Baathist military officers who fought us before, ended up in our jails, met jihadis in those jails, made common cause, and developed a new organization, right? An organization which, by the way, as far as I can tell, with the benefit of 2020 hindsight, which I think is fair in this case, because what we know now allows us to go back and winnow information that was lying around before, right? These guys already were getting their stuff together in 2010. And Mosul was already drifting out of our control in 2010. And remember, American forces were still in Iraq in 2010 and 2011. We were already losing Mosul. The bad guys were already back. ISIL was already on the move, right? And ISIL rebuilt itself in Iraq, right? So the reason I'm going through this list in particular is just to say just how much of the problem that we're treating as something that emerged yesterday, right, from some strange hatchery of jihadi hatred, right, is something with which we were intimately involved and had something to do with causing. Not entirely, right? These ideas were out there. I mean, Osama bin Laden was out there. If it wasn't this group, maybe it would have been a different one. But this group, we know. We have a real history here, right? We helped do this. We should also remember the larger story, right? Without much thinking about it, right, in the Middle East, we have knocked over two Leviathans. And then we've acted astonished when the state of nature breaks out. We knocked out the Gaddafi Leviathan, and we knocked out the Saddam Hussein Leviathan, right? And then suddenly it's the state of nature, a war of all against all. We saw it in Libya, we saw it in Iraq, and we'll almost surely see it in many other places. We don't have much knowledge of these places before we knock over these very unsavory folk, right? And we don't have much cause-effect knowledge of what to do after we've knocked over these unsavory folk. And we seem astonished that local groups who've been forced to live together because of, a brutal police state, right, suddenly have to live together and begin acting like competitors do, right? This is an old article I wrote, Security Dilemma, Ethnic Politics, right? It's this kind of thing, so a lot of the problem we face today is a result of a lack of restraint, right? Now, the Russia story is a bit murkier, but I think most of you know that the United States and with Western allies have not been particularly cautious in our re-engineering strategies in Eastern Europe and in the former Soviet Union, right? Now, I don't want to suggest that everything about Russia's behavior in recent months is driven by the way the West pressed them since the Cold War ended. Some of this was going to happen anyway just because they grew their power back, and states that have some power are going to want to have some purview. And since I do take nationalism seriously, I don't think we can discount, whatever tools Putin uses to get legitimacy in the country, right? But we do have to remember what we did. As the Cold War ended, we pressed Russia to the floor. I think that this historiography is beginning to become clearer on this, right? It wasn't a happy handshake into the Cold War, right? We sensed weakness, we pushed, right? We absorbed into NATO not only all of Russia's former allies in the Warsaw Pact, but several former republics. This is not to say that they didn't have a right to be independent. The Baltics have every right to be independent. The question was, did the Americans need to bring them into NATO? On and off, since the Cold War ended, we've talked about bringing other states into NATO, including Ukraine and Georgia. And the same with the European Union. And just as a side comment on questions about priorities and scarcity, when all of these NATO enlargement decisions were made, if you stuck your hand up and said, what happens if we ever have to make good on these commitments? Right? If you stuck your hand up and asked that question, people would kind of, in the policy world, would do the equivalent of looking at you and say, oh, you just don't understand, right? That's old think, right? People who'd come up and spent their whole lives in NATO doing nothing but force planning suddenly became converted to the idea that competitive international politics just wasn't coming back to Europe. It's all over, right? NATO is something else. It's not an alliance. It's a community, right? I kept asking them, what do we have to make good on these commitments? And suddenly, some of you may have noticed, others are asking, well, can you make good on these commitments? Probably can, but it wouldn't be easy, right? Do you want to offer nuclear guarantees to all these countries? Stop and think about that. No, this was not discussed. International politics, as we knew it, was over. A new form of international politics was going to reign, right? And these kinds of questions didn't matter anymore. And of course, you can pick your own history of the more recent events in Ukraine. And I'm not going to pretend to have assimilated, chapter and verse. The people who do this have their own positions on the evolution. But it did look to me like the European Union was a bit forward in its negotiations with Ukraine. And when things went bad, the U.S. State Department, I think you can say what you will, didn't seem to be acting so much as diplomats, but more like activists, and doing it really, as we know now, in full view of Russian intelligence. Right? And this doesn't send a good message to the Russians. So we're, again, moving the frontier in their direction. That's the way they're going to see it. Right? without really thinking it through, all in, you know, with the notion that we're strong enough to build the world we want, and the world we want is the right world, and others want this world. Oh, by the way, you know, we should remember that a lot of the problems in Ukraine stem from mobilized identity politics at both ends of the country, right? Those who think of themselves as Russian, those who think of themselves as Ukrainian, and they are the ones who were the most energetic in participating in the political events that we've seen. And you know, you can, if you wish, decide that one nationalism is to be preferred over another, but it seems to me that what we really need to do is understand that there's a lot of nationalist competition going in this area, not just within the country, but also involving Russia, right? And we should be asking, how do we, the United States of America, really need a piece of this? Is this something that really, that we know how to manage? And is this happening in a place where we have to take risks and commit resources because somehow American security is jeopardized by whether or not Ukraine is governed by a Western-leaning government or a Russian-leaning government or an incompetent government, right? These things are small beans compared to the larger security position of the United States. Now, so then people will sort of say, okay, fine, so, okay. But we are where we are. You know, classic Washington policy speak. You know, we are where we are, right? Which, of course, means that we got where we are because of where we were and what we did, and therefore we should do more of that. And my point of view is we should at least reflect, you know, stop and think, right? Just, you know, that's all I ask. So what would I say, you know, as a person who has a set of instincts and intuitions and causal models and whatnot that brought me to the state where I was recommending this less active strategy, what do I recommend here? Now, if you read the book, you'll see that I talk about three problems the United States does need to be mindful of. One is the political division of industrial Eurasia, you know, blocking the emergence of a true hegemon. Second, we need to be attentive to the problem of nuclear proliferation. My own view is we've just been attentive to it in the wrong way. Our principal interest is being sure that nuclear weapons are in the hands of states and not in the hands of groups. States you can deter, groups hard. And then third, we have learned that there are groups that, for whatever reason, decide that their problem, whatever it is, has an origin here, and a good way to do something about that problem is to do something here. And given the way the world works, you know, you can do a lot if you're creative, right? You can, you know, the city saw it, right? So I'm not, you know, I don't believe that, you know, you, when things emerge that could take you in this direction, that you just, you know, sort of brush them aside. Although I think a more committed restrainer could make that argument. But I do think that you want to be a little more discreet in terms of thinking about how you're going to deal with, say, ISIL, right? It could, at some future date, maybe be a threat to the safety of the United States of America. There could be a plot that originates there. And we should take this seriously. You know, when all this started, you know, I spent a couple days looking for evidence of ISIL's, you know, that, you know, malign intent towards the United States was really part of their thing. It was actually very hard to find it. Now, they were interested in many, many things, but the business about, you know, coming to North America or Europe to do damage was at best a footnote, and many of the experts who study this group would say so, right? So, you know, doesn't seem to be the clear and present danger that it's been painted by the policy community. Nevertheless, I mean, from a regional point of view, they are ambitious, and they've proven themselves to be somewhat militarily skilled, so they may threaten some other interests the United States has. You know, I talk about this in the book. I don't really resolve it. We've operated for years as if we have important strategic interests in the Persian Gulf that clearly relate to oil. We've acted this way. We've talked this way. We've fought over it. But when you try and peel away the argument and try and figure out exactly how does it work, it's not so easy to figure it out. I mean, we know that sort of back in the days of industrial mobilization, World War II, 40s, you know, if that was the war, you needed oil. You needed all you could get, right? But that doesn't seem to be the world we're living in, and it doesn't seem to be the reasons for all our energy, right? But be that as it may, I accept that somehow we have a consensus on this, right? And at minimum, we probably would prefer major oil states not to fall to conquest by an outside power. So it's possible that ISIL could be so successful that it could threaten one of these states. It's pretty unlikely, but it's possible, right? So my view is that we should think in terms of containment and observation versus this group, right? Which is rather different from the strategy that's been announced. The strategy that's been announced is we must go on the offense. And this has been kind of a mantra since 9/11. We must go on the offense, right? Well, we went on the offense in Iraq and Afghanistan. It didn't work out so well. So I don't know what going on the offense against ISIL means, but it sounds like trouble to me, right? I don't see that there's any land force in the region that can go into the areas that ISIL's taken, crush them, and then govern those areas. So the more we keep dancing around with that and the more obstacles we encounter, the more seductive it's going to be to begin adding American forces, ground forces, to the mix. And you're hearing it already from General Dempsey, right? You can see the writing on the wall, right? Supposedly there's 6 or 8 million Sunni Arabs living in ISIListan or whatever we're going to call it now, right? Well, a lot of those people greeted them as liberators. I mean, they weren't happy with their preceding governments, right? And if we go in there, shoo ISIL out, first of all, it's going to be bloody to shoo them out. We know they fight like devils, right? But second of all, a lot of people there are not going to be that happy to see us, right? Not just ISIL people, but other people, right? And we can't install the Kurds, can't install the Shiites. This is the problem, right? So I don't see offense as the solution. And the same with the ringing announcements of the 30-country coalition. Most of these countries are going to send 4 fighter planes. They're going to fly a handful of sorties. They'll offer a little training, a few dollars, right? It's tends to come back to the Americans, right? We're owning the war again. And by these ringing statements, we're encouraging free riding by local actors, and we're ignoring reckless driving by local actors that got us into this situation. Reckless driving by the Shiite government, reckless driving by the Kurds, reckless driving by the Saudis, right? All of which, right, we kind of just accept as sort of part of the, something we have to live with as a consequence of the way the hegemonic project works. So I think it was reasonable for the United States to try and stiffen the backs of the Baghdad regime, stiffen the backs of the Kurds, some weapons, some airstrikes, a little intelligence, right? When these guys are fighting for their own real estate, they tend to fight pretty hard, right? I also think it's reasonable, although you can't get any traction on it now, is I think we have to kind of ratchet way down our ambitions vis-a-vis the Assad regime. And I personally think we have to ratchet down our ambitions as far as Iran is concerned, right? Including their nuclear forces, if ISIL is to be taken seriously, right? But loose containment should be the project. It doesn't take much money. It doesn't take many sorties. It doesn't take many advisors. It doesn't take all that many weapons, right? And wait for these guys to do what they typically do, which is make mistakes. Sooner or later, they'll make themselves unloved. That's what they did before when they were in Iraq. They'll do it again, right? And when opportunities emerge, you can take advantage of those opportunities if it looks like a good bet. But that's the way a restrainer approaches a problem of this kind, right? With some sense of what we don't know. And, you probably know what I believe about Ukraine, right? I mean, I think the Crimea thing is done. That's gone. I think that the West is probably reasonable to try and discourage Putin over Luhansk and Donetsk just because the appetite can grow with the eating, so you might as well let him know that there are costs. But there should be offers on the table. And I think at this point they probably are. We just can't say it, right? In part because we have other fish to fry in other places, which is, Ukraine is a kind of a incohate loose buffer between the two of us. That's fine, right? We had that going for us before. It's what we should have kept. Why we were so, seduced into trying to do other things, has to do with our ideology, right? But this was a mistake, right? So I won't go, I don't want to keep talking forever here. I just want to just say something about, by way of summary, something I didn't talk about, but I think we have to think about as part of the backdrop here. There's probably greater scarcity of U.S. security resources, has something to do with our politics. There are more consequential powers abroad. There's going to be more of them. There's more politically mobilized and capable political and armed groups of every kind abroad. And to me, this all necessitates that the U.S. just play a tighter game. Be more careful, be more discriminate. Now, I think that incremental adjustment, which is what I think we're going to get, I think we will get incremental adjustment to these facts. I think it's not quite enough, but I do think it's going to happen. But if we could lean forward a little bit, I think the United States could set political and military priorities a bit more rigorously and subsidize the security of its allies a little bit less generously. And I think country would be better off. So.
So what do you think of Rand Paul?
I don't know the man.
We have good amount of time for discussion.
Thanks for that terrific presentation, Barry. Not surprisingly, my questions are about Russia, and I've got two. The first is, I thought you started out by saying that it was inevitable that other powers would rise and that Russia would come back. So how do you decide whether it's inevitable or whether the U.S. provoked it by NATO expansion and other things? And the second question is, what we saw in the Ukrainian elections that just happened on Sunday is, in fact, that the extreme nationalists did terribly. And the two parties that got the most votes were the moderate European parties, if you want to call them moderate. They fought the Russians. But nonetheless, they are mainstream Europeanists. What do you attribute that to? And does the United States have any ethical obligation to support countries that seem to be doing what we would like them to be doing in that way?
Do you want to take a few, or do you want to play ping pong?
We've got time, so why don't you go ahead?
This one isn't on.
Is this one working?
Yeah.
Yes. Here, this one works. Let's switch places.
Is this one? Maybe it's on now.
Yeah, it's on. Yeah.
Okay, fine. Well, I think there's, I think in the case of Russia, yes, their power was going to recover, right? The question is, what were they going to do with it, right? And I think you're sort of cutting to a problem we always have in international politics, which is, it's just very hard to tell what's a reaction and what's an action. It's just very hard to tell, right? But I think we can, one hint I think we can get here is by looking kind of over time, over the 20 years, and look at the way the Russia, even before they had power, the way both people in Russian civil society and the Russian state reacted to the various things the United States was doing, and I think you can see that they're pretty irked by it, right? Including the one episode, which I believe was in the Kosovo War, where somebody fired an RPG round at the U.S. Embassy in Moscow, right? I think that we have some evidence, right, that we had something to do with it, and there was some evidence that they were going to be somewhat bumptious in any case. Part of my argument is that we have to be a little bit realistic about other powers and their interests, right? So the notion that Russia doesn't have this way the Americans have of talking about things, which the Russians are challenging the world order. The world order they're challenging is the world order that we imposed on them when they were on their knees, right? Now, why should they, or any country, accept an order that was imposed upon them when they were on their knees, right? So my view would be, yes, their power has grown. We probably had something to do with their intentions being more malign, right? And we have to, I think, deal with both things. Try and do a little bit less of the things that I think probably help provoke them. Probably do a little bit more to try and understand what it is, what their security needs are. And at the same time, we have to do the third thing, which we always have to do in international politics, which is to send the message that, we get this and we get that, right? But this can only go so far, right? And that's why I sort of think the sanctions over Crimea and over Luhansk and Donetsk, it makes sense, because there has to be a message here that, tit for tat, we get that, but you don't get another round, right? You don't get to start another round, right? The Nationalists did terribly. Yeah, they did do terribly. I think that probably does tell you some important things, but, you know, to state the obvious, there's a lot of Nationalists who didn't vote, right? They're in these other two provinces, right? And it seems to me that's got to count for something. Now, the fact that these countries would rather be more Western-oriented than Eastern-oriented, these people would rather be more Western-oriented after everything that's happened, that doesn't surprise me. And I don't have any problem with that. I wouldn't sort of be the agent of pushing them back into Russia's orbit, right? But I do think that it's reasonable for the United States to ask itself the question, what kind of obligations does it want to incur, right, to allow these folk to live in a way, but more importantly, be a member of institutions that their next neighbor over finds to be a threat, right? And that means that we take on the obligation of defending them. And if you look at the distances and you look at the length of border, right, I think it begins to become pretty clear that this is a very demanding project, right? So we can talk about, you know, ethical obligations, it's fine, right? But we also have ethical obligations to the American people who pay for U.S. military power, and we have ethical obligations to consider whether we want to incur what are nuclear risks, right, to provide this much autonomy for this country, right? That's the way the question should be asked. Now, if in their infinite wisdom the American people all stick their hands up and say, fine, who is Barry Posen to stop them, right? My problem, right, is that the choices are not posed this way, right? The risk and costs are elided, right? While the principles are brought front and center. I just want everything to be considered in the mix.
I enjoy the talk as well. My question is about Iraq. So I very much agree with your assessment of what went wrong in the early years of the war. I guess if the starting point were, say, 2005, 2006, Maliki becomes prime minister, and the U.S. sees, after a few years, the way things are going under his regime in terms of the non-inclusive approach to the Sunnis, is there something we should have done differently in terms of our relationship with Maliki? Since, in my view, Maliki is a huge part of why we are where we are today.
All I can say is you could have tried, but he was pretty popular then. I mean, this is one of the things that, you know, that.
But he wasn't that popular. That's the question.
Well, he was popular enough to get himself prime minister. And this argument that these exclusive policies that he pursued were not policies that originated in his support base, it makes no sense to me. Now, it could be true that it was just this hapless guy, right, governing in a particular way, and the 60% of Shiites in the country really felt very badly about it. It's possible. But I don't see it as being the case. And then the second question, which I always ask, is, okay, so then what? So we're going to overthrow the Maliki regime. How are we going to overthrow the Maliki regime? He hasn't proven himself to be a catastrophe to his own followership. This is a country that pumps lots of oil. We don't have massive foreign assistance leverage over this guy, right? And so we're there fighting like mad. What could we do? Threaten to abandon the guy? Right? That wasn't an option. So I'm always skeptical, and people tell me there were all these choices and there's all this flexibility. I don't see them. I don't see how we had the cause-effect knowledge that would give us a kind of a moderate confidence way to tell ourselves the story. I know, well, we'll change this regime. I mean, there may even have been some vulgar, you know, historical analogies at work here, because we did a lot of this in Saigon. It didn't seem to help us all that much. Right? So I think we can play this out over and over again, you know, the woulda, shoulda, couldas.
right? But to me, it was kind of baked in the cake, right? That, you know, my colleague Roger Peterson talks about status reversal, right? And you took the Sunnis who were on top and you put them on the bottom. You took the Shiites from the bottom and you put them on the top. You set up a democracy, which meant votes count. They're 60% of the country. And then for your own convenience, you kind of gave the Kurds a way out. So in a weird way, the Sunnis and Shiites were locked into a kind of a cage fight with the Sunnis outnumbered 3-1, right? So how were we going to change that situation? I know it's very, you know, I saw this PBS documentary 2 weeks ago where all of the Bush support, the Bush foreign policy people are now saying that they told the president that Maliki was a very bad man and needed to be replaced, and it was crazy George Bush, the younger, who just liked Maliki and couldn't be moved, right? Now this is a bunch of people, I think, covering their tracks, right? So it could be true, but when I hear this, I just it just makes me cover my ears, because it suggests a level of insight into the society that I think most of our interactions with that society tell us we don't have.
Hi. American restraint sort of seems to fly in the face of American exceptionalism. And I was wondering if you had any thoughts of how you might make American restraint an acceptable part of American political discourse.
No, not really. I've studied international politics too long, and I've lived in cloistered academic communities for too long, and I've lived on the coast too long, right? So I actually don't think I understand my own country all that well. I do think that there is embedded in our history, you know, two versions of our mission. You know, one is the sitting on the hill version, and the other is the, you know, the Wilsonian, you know, take it to them version. And you know, it doesn't really. On both ends of the political spectrum, there are people who, for diametrically opposite reasons, think the country is off the rails. And neither group likes this foreign policy, right? I mean, who is my audience? It's the libertarian wing of the Republican Party and the handful of, you know, social welfare, you know, big state liberals that are left in the United States. I mean, these are the folk, right? And I think, you know, that you do have some evidence from polls that you know, over a long trend line, you know, over the 20 years, that, you know, public support, interest in foreign policy, activist foreign policy has kind of waned. And we can maybe make some guesses about that, right? But there's an argument that some politician, and they could be a politician of the right or the left, they make it in their own way, that says, you know, not just for the world, but for our own interests, our own imperfections need some work. We've spent a lot of time and money working on the imperfections of the rest of the world, not much working on our own, right? So there's an argument to be made that there's plenty of work to be done here, and you can pick your favorite pet rock. I mean, your pet rock could be the budget deficit, your pet rock could be access to higher education, your pet rock could be the parlous state of American infrastructure. You can have whatever pet rock you want in this larger, you know, envelope of, you know, what's wrong with the United States that we've kind of let go by the by, right? So I think there's fertile ground that can be planted. I think there are some counter elites that would like to make the argument, and I'm guessing that. You know, you're going to see more of it. Now, will they succeed? Hard to say, right? I mean, there's a lot of things that push us in the direction of what we do. We have allies who are accustomed to having us there, who threaten dire outcomes if we leave. You know, some allies threaten to, you know, to surrender, and the others threaten to go nuts, right? So this is, you know, one of the ways you You keep the Americans involved. You have a huge self-confident, self-replicating foreign policy elite that is endlessly creative about generating projects. You have a big military. The things we're good at have the unfortunate effect of making the first phase of the war easy and don't really make the second phase of the war easy, so it's not so hard to make the war seem cheap. So there's, you know, you're fighting against a lot, and the version of American exceptionalism that you discuss, and okay, I'll say something rude about the media. Media likes these dramatic stories from abroad, and they will bring them home in a certain way. It doesn't force you to do anything, but it makes the argument easier for those who want to do things. So it's just, there's a lot pushing it. You're totally right. But I've been surprised that, in contrast to the way this argument was treated when my colleagues Harvey Sapolsky and Daryl Press and Gene Gultz began advancing it in the early 90s, the argument is not, the opposition would like to, you know, marginalize the argument, but it doesn't seem to be working that way. I mean, there's some traction. Even in the face of ISIL and Ukraine and China and everything else, there's some traction. The tectonic plates seem to be moving to me.
So what do you think of Bernie Sanders?
Yeah, right. Let's move to Vermont.
I'm wondering if you can explain how you would articulate your support for the war in Afghanistan under the doctrine of restraint, and how far your support extended with respect to the state building project and the subsequent counterinsurgency campaign?
Well, I had a simple view at the time. In fact, I think Peter Lieber and I had an argument about it. Peter thought I was off the rails already, I think, when this first happened. But I have a simple view, which was, I went and looked into how many times the Taliban had been warned. Right, and they'd received many warnings from us, you know, not to.
You're talking about before September
11th. Yes, yeah, many warnings before September 11th. Right? And the thing that happened, which happened on their watch and which they facilitated, it was a big thing, right? And it was pretty obvious their complicity. And I believe that, you know, we live in a deterrence world, right? So that regime needed to be hit, right? And I had no problem with hitting it. Now, I remember at the time having arguments with two kinds of people. One, the old Afghan hands who thought that this was finally the moment to do what we ought to have done at the end of the, you know, when the Soviets left, which is pour on a state-building project. And I told those people I didn't agree, right? You know, first we want to knock over the regime, then we want to find Osama bin Laden. Those were my only objectives, right? And I thought they were reasonable objectives. Right? And I had arguments with people on the other end of the spectrum when the USG raised, you know, when the US government waged that war with such pusillanimity, right? And particularly the problems of, you know, when they probably had Osama cornered and let him slip away, right? To me, this was crazy. I was tearing my hair out, right? I said, you know, and we come to find out afterwards their heads were already in an Iraq game. Well, to me, this is talk about having your priorities wrong. Right? So that was my view. I didn't think we had to get too deep into the nation state building game. I can't offer you a very sophisticated assessment of what my alternative would have been, but, you know, make deals, you know.
What do you think about the proposition that if the U.S. Gives in and on these minor issues, it would have some consequences for the larger picture in form of lacking credibility among allies if we rein in on U.S. policy? One obviously thinks about Iraq as a case that this doesn't apply, but we shouldn't forget that immediately after the Iraqi invasion in 2003, it had the effects that the Iranians stopped their nuclear program temporarily. Gaddafi, he gave up his nuclear program. And what do you think about that?
Well, I'm not so concerned about American credibility to its allies. And the reason I'm not concerned about it is because everything I see tells me we have too much credibility vis-a-vis our allies, not too little. Right? I mean, given the way the allies behave, right, the cheap riding and reckless driving, I think we would have to do an awful lot to lose credibility with our allies. And the second question is, so what are they going to do if they don't like the services we provide, right? The Europeans are going to sign up and join the Russians. The Japanese are going to sign up with the Chinese. This doesn't seem very plausible to me. So I'm not so worried about that, right? Now, you may say that a more restrained policy may cause some direct challengers to doubt the American willingness to fight for certain things, right? So that could be true, right? But if that's a problem, then rich allies, and we're talking about rich allies, can do things on their own account to shore up the if nothing else, the capabilities that go into making a commitment to defend credible, right? There's enormous underutilized resources in the alliance. This is not 1947 or 48 where the allies are all prostrate and can't do anything in their own defense. They can do lots. Now, what spokesmen for the allies like to do when I say this is the Europeans will peddle the argument that they're now all lambs, sheep, and they just can't defend themselves, don't know how to think about defending themselves, couldn't mobilize support for defense spending if their lives depended on it. You either believe this or you don't, right? I don't believe it. I think most nation states will defend themselves when they feel like they're being threatened, right? Now, you could say and make another argument, which I think is plausible, which is the Europeans spend exactly as much on defense as they need to, given the threat that they face. And they may not spend more because the threat isn't very great.
Right. They decide to get nuclear weapons.
Two countries do have nuclear weapons. France and Britain do have nuclear weapons, right? I talk about this in the book, right? The same is true of Japan. Japan might decide to get nuclear weapons in the fullness of time. South Korea might decide to get nuclear weapons in the fullness of time, right? Some people are more concerned about this than others, right? I'm less concerned about this, right? I personally believe that just looking at the logic of deterrence, any nuclear threat that a country can make on its own behalf to defend itself is infinitely more credible than any nuclear threat that another state can make on its behalf. Extended deterrence is difficult, and extended deterrence has led the United States into some, let's just call them very interesting nuclear and conventional strategies. Nuclear and conventional strategies that are, in my judgment, are high risk, right? And I did a book about it. Dick talked about it, Inadvertent Escalation. We're doing the same thing. We're going to do the same thing with the Chinese. Now, so I think if you look at the problem fully, right, then you have to start thinking about where the risks lie. In other words, or is it riskier for the United States and for others for us to be in the extended nuclear deterrence game? Or is it risky for some of the states we care about, riskier for other, some of the states we care about, to have their own nuclear weapons, right? Now, I don't think we're there yet, right? But I'm not too concerned about that prospect in the cases that I'm talking about, right? This is not reason enough for me to be willing to continue the strategy we have, which is both risky and costly. Now, I agree with you in your observations about how some states behaved better after the Americans, you know, sort of intimidated Saddam Hussein. But you may recall that the Iranians started behaving better before we invaded Iraq, right? They started behaving better right after 9/11 because they were bloody interested in not being in our gun sights, right? Because we were aroused, right? So I credit all that, but then we should look at the other side, right? You go and you knock over a state like Iraq, and then you end up in one of these long state building counterinsurgency situations, right? And pretty soon it's sucking up force and political energy, and pretty soon the others stop being afraid of you, right? And in fact, you may recall that the Iranians then saw that Iraq was a perfect situation for them to cheaply impose lots of costs on the United States, which they did do, right? So these energetic activities, right, they have costs and they have risks, right? Now, when it comes right down to choosing which set of costs and risks that you want to accept, a lot of this is subjective. This is political. We would like to believe we have a science, we have a political science that tells us what to do, right? I'm not arguing that we have a political science that tells us what to do. We have to integrate too many variables, too many causal arrows. So at some point, we do the best we can, and we decide which set of costs and risks do we want to accept. Right? I think that the ones that we've been doing have been unnecessary and somewhat costly. And I think given the trends, they're going to become more costly and more risky. And that's why I'm making the argument that I'm making.
Gary, your inclination is to argue from the standpoint of a fairly stripped down notion of the U.S. national interest. But when
you had a question at the end of your voice.
But when I hear you analyze specific foreign policy problems, it sounds like it doesn't matter whether you take that starting point or some other starting point assumption about whose interests you're serving, how expansively you might want to define U.S. national interests in a leadership role, or whether you just wanted to be moralistic or humanitarian. It sounds to me like your arguments are almost entirely about means and not about objectives, and that you don't have to anchor your arguments on U.S. national interests. You could argue from any of those other standpoints and still make the case that your brand of restraint would serve those interests or moral objectives better. And so I'm wondering if you agree with that. And I'm also wondering why you choose to start with the stripped down U.S. national interest criterion.
A complicated question. I started with the stripped down. Let me back up a second. I wanted to see how far I could get, you know, analytically, with a stripped down version of American national interests, right? Because when you back out of it, when you say I'm concerned about means, I am concerned about means, right? All my concern is driven by concern really about one means, right? Which is that anarchy means that war is possible. Anarchy means states need to be ready for war. Anarchy means that states sometimes have to wage war. Anybody who studies war knows it's horrible. It's about the worst alternative, and yet we do it. And I basically devoted my life to studying war, right? To me, war is the biggest problem that states face, right? It still is. It's the riskiest one. It's a way to get into a lot of mischief. The Americans seem to reach for the implement a lot. So I tried to organize my thinking around that question. In other words, the reason I talk about grand strategy and not foreign policy, because I'm trying to cut to the chase of how we think about when, where, how we will use military, should use military means, right? So you're right that means are an organizing principle, but means are an organizing principle because of, in a way, it's my own ethic, right? And my own ethic is that war itself and its instruments requires focused, refined attention in its own right, right? Now, when you say that you could make these arguments in another way, yeah, you probably could make these arguments in another way. I've tried making these arguments in other ways, in different venues. Now, I'm not particularly good at making arguments about other ways to cause democracy abroad. I don't know how to cause democracy abroad, right? But I do sometimes, when we have these discussions about humanitarian intervention, then I can think about sort of what are the probabilities that you will produce a humane outcome by using force in a certain way. Right, and there we can have an ethical, a conversation about sort of, we'd like to maximize the number of people in this, whatever this horrid place is, that are not losing their lives as a consequence of violence, right? Often internal violence, right? So I have friends who they look at these autocrats, these violent autocrats like Saddam or Gaddafi, and they look at the way they repress their political opposition, and they see the shooting in the streets, and they see the dead, and to them, there's a humanitarian problem that's right there in front of them, and their argument is we achieve a humane goal by putting our forces between that vicious thug and his victims, right, his challengers, right? And that's a humane story. And that means that the next N people who would have been shot by the thugs will not be because we killed the thugs for them, right? So if you draw the circle there, you can tell yourself a story about a humane outcome. And you're totally right to say this. I don't need to talk about my interests. I just need to say, let's say I'm as interested as you are in causing humanitarian outcomes, right? But my social science tells me that if I knock over the regime, there's going to be a war of all against all. And if you think things are bloody now, wait till that happens, right? And then I can say, there's another ethical question here. We might be able to prevent the war of all against all if we're willing to send, you know, 20 troops per thousand of local population in order to keep the peace, which is kind of the canonical number, which drives you up to big numbers pretty fast, right? And I want to be sure you think that's an ethical outcome, right, for other ethical choices you have. So we can have a conversation that way, but I find that when I have it, including with people who I respect, you know, committed humanitarian operatives whom I respect, they'll look at me and they'll say, you know, I think I agree with you, but I think you're tricking me somehow. Right? And these are people who've seen these things unfold several times, right? So you can have a different kind of discussion about these. I chose to do it this way. It's the primary way that I think, and it permits a kind of economical organization, right? But we could, there are alternatives. I think there are alternative ways to think about some of these things. She's been really patient. You got to give her the mic.
Oh,
she's going to drive me crazy with
Thank you, Barry. So actually, that's the theme of my question. So your doctrine of restraint seems to extend even to the free riders and the reckless drivers that you talk about, which kind of puzzles me. So I wonder whether there's some hardball politics that you think is worth playing. In Europe, for example, contrary to what you once thought earlier, about a decade ago, the Europeans didn't generate a independent security force of their own. It turned out all to be a fairy tale. And as you correctly say now, they're still cutting their defense budgets, including Germany. Mm-hmm. So why doesn't the United States play hardball and instead of rising to the occasion and always stepping up, say, you know, there's more you can do, and we'll do a little bit now in this period of crisis, but then we have other things we need to do. You're on your own to do more, or hand over the keys to NATO. And in Japan, similarly, we could play hardball and say to the Japanese, you're entrapping us with all this nationalism potentially in a war with China that we don't want to fight, and we may face the Barry Posen scenario of escalation, which we don't want to face. So why don't we play more hardball with them as well? And why is that not part of your policy of restraint at the operational, diplomatic, and security level? Thank you.
Restraint is hardball, right? I mean, I talk a lot in the book about moving forces around. It's the one thing that seems to get their attention is pulling forces out. So I think we should pull a fair amount of forces out. And I think we should be more aggressive. I mean, you know, I had to wrestle with, you know, this problem, and you can, you know, I don't think there's a single solution, but I had to wrestle with this problem that I do still care about a hegemon in Asia, and I do see the trends in China, but I also see the behaviors of the allies, right? So in that space, I'm more interested in playing your game, right? In other places, I just don't think it's worth it. I think the better way to play the game is to say, here's the keys to the car, right? You can do this and you will, right? Now, the The more interesting question, it seems to me, is why doesn't the foreign policy establishment that we have work these problems more aggressively, right? And this is a very interesting question, right? And I've come around to the view that maybe John Mearsheimer has the best answer. Not that he's tried to answer the question, that there's an offensive realism part of this. Americans don't just want to be stronger than their enemies. They want to be stronger than their allies. So even though we talk about burden sharing, we don't really mean it, right? And the EU story is an interesting one. You're totally right. I mean, I thought I saw something happening, and then it stopped. But in the course of pursuing that hypothesis, which turned out to be wrong, one thing did become very clear to me. The Americans did everything they could to crush the European Union as an autonomous military actor. And the question is, what was that all about, right? And that is about the hegemony part of liberal hegemony, right? So we have to accept that, you know, some of what we're doing here is explained not by defensive realism as we like to think of it, but by offensive realism.
I think we have time for one more if we're going to get Barry to his next commitment.
Yeah. Which ought to be a drink.
That's what I had in mind.
Take one, Tony.
One here and one there.
You want to just take them all?
Well, okay, just repeat all your questions at once concisely, and he'll answer them all at once.
Actually, in one single sentence.
My question is about the intellectual history of the non-restraint position. And essentially, it boils down to how deep a hole do you think we're dug into? You talk in your book about liberal hegemony being the foreign policy, the grand strategy, rather, of the last 20 years. A couple of days ago, Andy Bacevich was here, and he talks about 1980, the Carter Doctrine, as the turning point. And, of course, one can make an argument that the date that one should use is 1944 or 45 or 48. And if it is, if it does go back, you know, minimum of one generation, maybe two or three, what gives you any reason to believe that one can walk it back?
Barry, I'm just curious, how would you put Joseph Nye's soft power into your prognosis?
Okay.
Is that a mischief question? That's
Can you please comment on the drumbeat of articles in a prestigious newspaper in New York City about the Obama administration is over its head?
The Obama administration's what?
Over its head because of all the crises and they're tired and they're run down and God help us.
They should start. They need to drink more sports drinks. Is that it? Are we? Okay, so the intellectual history question. This is a great question, you know. And the more this is one of the questions. Sort of after I'm sort of deep in the book and trying to finish it, I begin to start to ask myself the same question, right? And I think it should be situated in a larger question, which is, we probably, apropos my earlier comments about John Mearsheimer, I think we kind of maybe we should just for fun do a historical reinterpretation of the Cold War. Right, and ask who really was containing whom, right? You know, it is noteworthy that the Soviets had about half as much GDP as we had at purchasing power parity. We were the big dog, not them. Right? We had the expeditionary force on the continent that they lived in. They didn't have the one on ours. The one time they tried, put these missiles in Cuba, we threw them out and told them they were going to get incinerated if they didn't. Right? So, looking at the absence of restraint, It could be that we look, and it probably is, if Ken were here, he would say, look, we were restrained in the Cold War because there was another power, right? I mean, there was another dog out there that was big enough to bite, so we had to be more calculating. And the difference between what you were doing to defend and what you were doing to advance your interests, hard to tell in a situation where, we're at each other like this, right? But the point is, we're at each other like this. We're not kind of both sitting around sleeping, because otherwise you don't end up with 60,000 nuclear weapons if we're all just kind of
if we've somehow achieved MAD and we're just kind of living together in this odd box, you know, how do you need 60,000 weapons? How are we always, you know, competing with one another? So the better way to think about it is the opposing force left. And when I mentioned the historiography of the cult, my former student Josh Shifrinson has got a great big thesis where he's wallowed in all these documents that we have from the time and interviewed lots of people. And it didn't take us very long in the diplomacy of seeing the Soviet situation to sort of for the light to go on. Maybe we got them, right? So we pushed, right? And as they got weaker, we pushed, and we've been pushing since. Now, it makes you want to go back and reinterpret the entire thing as much more of a mutual pushing thing than they're pushing and we're pushing back, right? Much, you know, somewhat different, right? That doesn't mean that's a right interpretation. You know, history is that way, right? But you might surface some interesting things that would give you insight into your question, which I think is a really good question. And so when you ask about how deeply ingrained is it in us, you know, maybe we've been liberal hegemons all the time, for a long, long time, right? It's just the conditions created a perfect storm for us to go on a kind of imperial jag, but those conditions, we may still be able to agree that those conditions are passing, and maybe we have to think about things in a different way. Soft power? I never understood this.
Soft power rests on hard power.
Yeah, and this is not the same as saying that I don't believe things like legitimacy matter. And if legitimacy is soft power, then sure, I believe in it, right? I mean, we spend, you know, even hard-bitten realists, you know, master statesmen in history would try and, even if they were trying to set up an aggressive war, they wanted it to look like it was forced upon it by somebody else, right? So, you know, legitimacy matters because it's a cheap way. It's cheap, right? So you don't have to shoot anybody. You don't have to So if it only matters a little, given how cheap it is, you should be trying to get some, right? So in that sense, I think, you know, it does matter, right? But these things go hand in hand. And then there's a whole other set of questions that are, in a way, beyond my analysis. Could America have a very interesting, ambitious foreign policy that wasn't part of its grand strategy? This is not about defending us. And we're not identifying the spread of democracy as being something we need to do kinetically because it defends us. We would just like to help whenever we can, and wherever it's cheap or wherever we have, you know, something that we can bring to the table, we'll do it. And you make a few friends and you build a little legitimacy, and isn't that great? I got no problem with that, right? It's where you're talking both languages at the same time and not disentangling what your actual purposes are that kind of makes me, it actually makes me crazy. I mean, people who are around me when it happens will tell you it kind of makes me crazy. And then is the Obama administration over its head? Let's see now, the largest thing that I run is about a 20-person tour, 3-day tour of American military installations, right? And this is all, I can't do this without serious administrative help. So imagine me being the person who tells, you know, says, well, I could do a better job running the show. Maybe they're tired. Maybe they're just who they are. Maybe the problems are particularly intractable. There's lots of explanations you could deduce. Maybe the president is not well served by his advisors, which happens to be what I believe on alternate Thursdays, right? Now, when people tell me, see, the president tried your restraint strategy, and I go, not really. But if that was his impulse, if he had hoped to do that, he might have surrounded himself with more restrainers instead of surrounding himself with liberal hegemonists. It's pretty hard to run a restraint strategy when you've got people rooting for you to do a surge in Afghanistan, you know, rooting for you to knock over the Gaddafi regime, rooting for you to knock over the Assad regime. And you look around on your side of the table, there's only a handful of really kind of domestic political operatives who are saying, hey, boss, your original insight about the American people and land war is probably right, you know. But all the rest of these experts are telling, you know, go, 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 right? And, you know, at minimum, he should have people around him who are loyal, which I don't think he does. And I hope after this election some heads roll. It's not going to happen, but I'd like to see it. And in the fullness of time, any president who has these instincts will have to look long and hard to find some apparatchiks to implement them, right? Because, you know, you couldn't trust me to do anything in government. I've lived my life a certain way for too long. I don't know how to make the trains run on time. Right? So finding the folk who somehow came up in the system and got socialized and know how to push the button and know how the interagency process works, right? Who are also ready to pursue a different strategy because they're making their careers off liberal hegemony. To get them to switch horses, find ones willing to switch horses, pretty tricky business, right? So there's a whole other implementation phase here that's very interesting that I am not optimistic about.
Well, you've earned your drink.
Amen.